Hi, good afternoon. My name is Kavyal Sedani. I am a counselor, I am a hypnotherapist, and I work majorly with children. The purpose of my life and the passion of my life are both children and kids. And a lot of my purpose and passion changed when I had two children of my own. They are now 10 and 9 years old. But children are wonderful. They teach you so much compassion, they teach you love, they teach you tolerance, they teach you patience. They teach you how to survive in a very, very messy house. They teach you how to survive in intolerable decibel levels in the house the whole time. They also make you very smart. They make you very clever because they can be so crafty and they can be such good politicians. They know how to pitch you against your spouse and they know how to pitch you against your mother-in-law and your father-in-law. And they keep making the most of every situation. And we keep thinking they're harmless, you know. Either we are talking to our best friends or we are talking to our parents and we are complaining about something and that child is doing their coloring and drawing and whatever. And for all you realize, at the opportune moment, when you need your child to keep quiet, your child will quietly come to you and say, "Dadi ko bolu." So they are very, very smart politicians. And it's amazing, you know, the amount of threshold they have to learn things, to go through things. But at the same time, they're also very, very vulnerable. They can be very soft targets for mental health. And that is why I choose this topic to speak about the mental health of children, because more than the children, it's the parents who are now often paranoid. So you all have kids, you all have played with kids, neighbors' kids, family's kids, and all the kids are different, right? For all of those who don't have the children, well, you must have kids, or at least, you know, consider it if you're not considering it, because sometimes when you're tired and when you just come back from office and you know you just lie down there and you don't have the energy to move, having a baby is a really good thing when you want somebody to go and get the remote from the next sofa, or you want somebody please open the door or switch on the light. They are very happy to do those odd jobs. But more than that, they are a blessing. Let's focus on this blessing today. So the mental health issues that children can face, let's go through some of them.
From which age to which age they face this?
They face these issues all the time, possibly from the age of one or from birth itself, and it could go on and on until it's diagnosed. But there are some very, very basic issues that children face. Now if you have, as a counselor, I'm dealing with so many parents and so many queries all the time, and half of them are really common sense. So the way you have this help library here, and the reason you have a library here is so that you can come and research and do your homework. And when you find out some very basic things, you can help yourself, right? So the entire agenda of today's talk is so that if you understand the basics of what's going wrong with children, you can help them heal faster without getting anxious. A very common case that comes to me all the time is this: my child doesn't study, my child is too lethargic, my child doesn't like to focus. Every time I put a book in front of this child, my child just wants to go to sleep. Now I want you to open your eyes and see whether this is a physical issue first. Because we always try and see that if there is a problem, in children check for sleep and eating patterns. If their eating patterns and their sleep patterns are okay, then we check for neurological problems. If neurological problems, that means the birth weight, the birth cry, the trauma during birth and all of that was in place and they have been comfortable, only then we look for psychological problems. Right? So let's check what are the basics with the physical issues that children can have. And the first one is their mood swings. Now the moods of the child depend on the cerebrospinal fluid in our spine. In our spine, we have a fluid which is connecting to our brain. The more there is activity, the more this fluid gets used up. This fluid is made up of salts and sugars. Now when the salts and sugars in our body are going low, you know what happens. You know what we talk about, low blood sugar. right? And then we feel like eating something namkeen and we feel like eating something meetha. What does that do to us? It stabilizes our mood somewhere. Okay, so when the cerebrospinal fluid is going low in the child, the salt and sugar is going low, no moong and khakra or apples are going to work. A lot of mothers nowadays are very cautious about, no, I give my child fruit in their tiffin, I give my child moong in their tiffin, I give my child only sprouts in their tiffin. And then we have to wonder whether the child is actually eating in dabba khali aata hai. Lekin pet mein gaya ke kacche ke dabbe mein gaya. Or whether he has traded that dabba with somebody else and stolen a samosa from the canteen. Because activity levels are so high. If activity levels are high, salt and sugar is going down, the child will need salt and sugar. So the first thing they pick up is junk. And we complain why they're eating junk. And we are worried they can't digest it. Well, a child can digest stones also. For us as adults, whatever takes 7-8 hours to digest, the child will digest in 45 minutes. So first check for food and eating habits. Make sure that the child is not only eating healthy food. Healthy food doesn't necessarily have to be boring food. It has to be tasty because they are going to need the spices. Okay? Once the food is in place, the moods are in place. Second, sleepiness. The minute you put a book, the child is wanting to sleep. Otherwise, bhaag raha hai, daud raha hai, football ke baad, cycle ke baad, cricket ke baad, something else. But they won't sit. But the minute you cook a book, where mamma and sleeping. And parents can get judgmental about their own children. As parents, we always think that dusre ka bachcha better hai, mere wale se. We are always comparing. Okay, so we are very quick to point flaws and every time I put a book in front of you, you feel like you're just sleeping. But if the magnesium levels are low, the brain is not receptive to take such slow activities like reading or writing. Check for magnesium levels. If magnesium levels are not okay, you can always give them substitutes. You can always give them powders which are very high in magnesium. You can always give them foods which are very high in magnesium. Okay.
Which food is high in magnesium?
A lot of green leafy vegetables are good. A lot of, you can give them the, what do you call them? I have a list of it, I'm just going to give you that list a little later. I don't have the English words for them. I'm going to give it to you a little later. Then low vitamin D. A very, very common cause of lethargy and bad body language. If you see that your child is always walking with shoulders drooping, back slouched, not feeling very good, no matter what you do, is always looking tired, face is always looking like uska neend hi nahi hua hai, has not slept enough. That's when you need to check for vitamin D levels. As children, we are not getting enough vitamin D because there's so much traffic outside. Houses are smaller, we don't have the gardens and the parks anymore. They don't go out. They only go out in the evening when there's no sun. So where do they get their vitamin D from? Every time you're sitting in front of the computer, you're sitting in the tube lights, it's taking away that vitamin D from you. Low vitamin D, low energy levels in the body. And when you start taking vitamin D substitutes or medication or injections, it takes at least 3 months for the results to show up. So it's not like you take vitamin D shots or take in 2 D rice sachets and by the 3rd week you should say, hey, I've been giving you medicine for 2 weeks, I don't see any results, what is wrong with you, you're just lazy. Be patient for 3 months. It's going to take 3 months for their energy levels and their body language to repair itself.
Best is sunshine, yeah?
Yes, it is, but early morning. Now early morning sunshine is not available now because children are running to school at 6:30 in the morning and then they're cooped up in their classrooms. By the time they come out, it is so hot that it's unbearable. And the midday sun is not good for vitamin D in any case. So we are missing out on these because of our lifestyles. Then there is low calcium deficiencies. I don't know if you've heard a lot of parents complain, especially of much younger children, that my child is chewing their nails. My child is eating chalk. Have you heard of those complaints that they pick up chalk from the classrooms and they keep eating chalk, they keep licking the walls. Or they pick up mud and they eat mud. The body is a very, very smart mechanism. We generally think that we eat what we like to eat. True. But But we also eat most what we need the most. So if your child is eating chalk, eating mud, what is it pointing at? A low calcium level. Be very happy in giving them the extra calcium pills or the palak or the dahi or the milk or whatever it is that you want to give them. Just make sure that it's tasty. Cheeses, milk is something that there are two opinions about it. Especially the Indian population thinks that we should be having milk every day of our lives to maintain our bones and retain our bone structure. There is another school of thought which says that we can only and only digest milk up to the age of 3. Only up to the age of 3 does our body make these enzymes which can digest and break down that milk so that it can be used up. After 3 years, that milk is a useless thing. So if your child is dealing with a lot of colds and coughs, a lot of cold issues constantly, a lot of doctors will advise first stop the milk, stop the sugar. But the milk products are still something that you can give them. Keep a good hold on the green leafy vegetables for calcium also. Dill is also very good for calcium. Nuts are very good for magnesium and calcium. Okay? Deworming checks are very important for the children. Because at this age, they are again eating everything that comes into their hands. A lot of bacteria going in. A lot of sugar going in. A lot of high excessive sugar is going to cause worms in their body. Because their bodies are small. More food is going in, can't digest. So the classic symptoms, knowing that you have worms in your body, they will complain of leg cramps very often. My legs are paining, my legs are paining, my legs are paining, or my legs are cramping up. Check for deworming. Sugar cravings all the time. No amount of meetha is good enough. Teeth grinding at night. Bruxism. It can also be psychological, but for very young children, we again need to check for deworming. And itching at the anus. All of these are signs for doing a deworming check for your child.
I think deworming should be once in 6 months.
Not more than once in 6 months. Not more than, because the medication also has alter effects on the body. Again, a lot of doctors say that certain medications of deworming, though now the medications have improved, they kind of create certain white spots on the skin. So not more than once in 6 months. But if you don't have these complaints, once in a year is a good enough practice for deworming.
Even the worms can travel, you know, they say up to the brains, even the
yes.
Brain is very dangerous.
Yes, they can be very dangerous. Of late, there have been a couple of
yes, yeah. Eye specialists, they remove the AC.
Yes. So, these germs can multiply very, very quickly and lay eggs in your system very quickly. So, we do need
they
to...
They lay in the eggs, you know, these...
Yes. And they can be fatal also. But I'm sure that we don't need to worry so much about the drastic effects. These are one in a million cases. But generally for the normal complaints of children, this is something that we can do. Now, how many of you have complained of your own children being very aggressive? Maarta hai. He goes and hits anybody, he gets very angry. My child is always angry. He's always upset, he's throwing tantrums, he's throwing fits. Every time a case like that comes to me, and this case will come to me once in 3 days. So every 3 days there is a case with angry child, aggressive child, can't control his temper. And this starts from the age of 2. It's not at the age of 8 or 9 or 10. It starts from the age of 2. Like I said in the beginning of the session, kids are fantastic politicians. They know exactly what tactic works. They know that the minute they throw an anger fit, the parent is going to be like, you know, stop it, okay, take what you want. Okay? But when it's a genuine issue of your child being too aggressive or not being patient enough or being calm enough, at that time the first thing we need to check is who in the house is aggressive. Because a child can only learn behavior through watching and experiencing it. Somebody is handling this child in an angry, aggressive manner. As
it is not a natural in his nature.
What is this nature that we are talking about? It's learned behavior. If your child was natural with a lot of things, he possibly could have been born learning Chinese. Correct? But the fact that he has learned language that we speak, the fact that he has genetically got a lot. True. But again, genetically, is somebody very angry in your house? You or your spouse or your parents, for whom it is such a strong emotion. But generally, children are like sponges. They will take whatever they see. Body language is 65% of communication. Non-verbal communication is maximum. Verbal communication is very little. So I have seen parents, when the child is screaming and shouting, the parent's reaction is, "Can you please stop shouting?" And in my head I'm wondering, you're asking the child to not shout by shouting? How does that work? Because what is the child learning? The child is learning that this is the way I speak. Or if you don't have that much patience also, what you're going to go and whack the child. The child is going to keep quiet. But what has the child learned? Oh, if you need somebody to keep quiet, you go and back them. So again, aggression is learned behavior. Now this child is small. They can't hold aggression. So if you go and slap this child, within 1 week, that slap will definitely be transferred to somebody else.
Yes.
Definitely. Then you'll get a complaint from school, or you'll get a complaint from a mother, or from the bus. Your son has hit my son. Your daughter has hit my daughter. And then you wonder who has hit this child over the last 7 days. Aggression is learned behavior and it's passed on.
And they learn through the eyes, not through the ears.
Yes, that's what I'm saying. Body language. 65% you learn by watching, more than listening. So if you need your child to calm down, you really need to bring that child close. Be with the child on an eye to eye level. And then tell the child, "You're too loud. I can't hear you. Speak softly." Because until unless you speak softly, or until unless you calm down, I can't help you. But you have to tone down your voice for the child to know, okay, this is what is expected out of me. Till then they don't know. Till then they are drift out. Jo dekhte hai, wo uthate. And do you even know this, that a child carries the personality of the person who touches them the most. So we also have these cases coming to us very often, which are, they classically sound like this. The parents will come and say, "My child has started speaking very funnily to us. We don't know what the problem is. Hamare ghar mein koi bhi aise nahi bolta. Nobody speaks like this. He eats also in a very funny manner. He chooses to sit down on the floor and eat. He won't sit with us on the table. And he likes to stay in the kitchen. He likes to play with the utensils. We got him an iPad, but no, he wants to do that only. And of late he has started abusing. We don't ever use those abuses in our house. We don't know where. And he's in a very good school. There's no chance they speak this kind of language in school. We don't know where it's coming from." And if the child is under 5 or 6 years old, the first question is, who is touching this child the most? And when we ask, and they say, "The maids." So if the maid is waking your child up, if the maid is dressing your child, if the maid is dropping him to school, picking him up from school, feeding him, putting him to sleep, waking him up again, taking him down, holding him, bringing him, who touches this baby carrying? The maids. So whose personality does the baby take over? The maids. Right? In the same way, anger and aggression is also passed through touch.
So anything wrong thing they learn from the maids, you know?
Yes, yes, that's what I'm saying. The influence is going to be highest of the person who is touching the child the most. And even if it is a parent, but if you are anxious and if you are touching the child, that anxiety is going to be passed through touch. Why do these babies cry so much after they are breastfed or after, you know, they are just born? You know, some children are very calm. They will sleep 12 hours, wake up for a feed again, sleep 4 hours. Then some children are, the minute you put them down, they are crying. And they, you just can't feed this baby enough. And the more you feed the child, the more the child cries, those 5 minutes the child is okay. After that, again the child is crying. And then you keep rushing to pediatricians and doctors. What's happening there? If it's a very anxious mother, especially if it's the first child, mothers are paranoid. अरे उसका नाक नहीं दब गया ना, उसका हाथ तो बराबर है ना, वो सांस तो बराबर ले रहा है, is he okay? Am I doing this right? If the mother is anxious and doesn't have the confidence in holding the child and feeding the child is also grappling and grasping. The child is also not comfortable. The child is also breathing in anxiety. The more you breathe in air and breathe in anxiety, the more gas you collect in your stomach. The more gas you collect, the more colic you get. The more colic you are, the more you cry. But if it's a relaxed mother and she is feeding the baby and she is doing her own thing, or she is singing a tune in her head, or she is talking to whoever she wants to talk to, and she knows that the child is okay, the mother is comfortable. That mother's baby will be like a harbor light. Nobody will even know that the baby exists. Till the baby grows up and starts crawling and starts walking, he will do his thing, he will feed himself, he will get up, he will eat, he will sleep. Comfortable, smiling baby. Again, personality is passed on through touch. Okay? Small frame kids. You know, you will see a lot of kids who are normal height, normal weight. You will see some kids who are much smaller. You will see some kids who are much larger than their size. The much larger kids normally have a show of power. They feel powerful. Height zyada hai, body zyada hai, they feel good. So even in these cartoons that you see a Doraemon or you see something else, the bigger child is always the bully. That's the mindset. And the smaller child is always the victim. Because the smaller children are always scared that, Baba, I am so small, what if this guy comes to hit me? So as a way of self-protection, they start hitting first only, as a way of self-defense. Nobody should touch me, so I'm going to get aggressive to protect myself. It's a learned mechanism. Because otherwise people just push them and shove them around. Because they feel like, so small, what's he going to do? Powerless. So to show that power and to protect themselves, they become aggressive. Here we need to check if the child is facing a complex because of his very small frame. Okay? Then there is PAB, something that we call passive aggressive behavior. Anger is not always loud and destructive. Anger can be very subtle. You will never even know that this thing is going on. Have you seen the common jokes of waiters in restaurants where they say, don't scream or shout at a waiter if the food is not okay. You never know what he'll take the food inside into. And there are common jokes that the minute you have screamed at the waiter, he's going to take that plate inside, he'll say, okay, I'll change it, he'll change it, he'll spit in it and he'll bring it back to you. Do you even know? You don't. Passive aggressive behavior. It's passive on the top. You can't see anything. The child will be as quiet as the ocean. What's happening inside? Because that anger is an emotion. Emotion has to come out. So some or the other way, it will come out. But anger that can't be caught on the top is passive aggressive. A lot of times we suffer from passive aggressive behaviors towards ourselves. We are so angry at ourselves for so many reasons that even if we can do something good, we don't allow it. So even if I can go for a walk, I'm not going to go. I have too many excuses. I'm so tired. I've worked so hard. Let me just relax. Now we know that that walk is important for us. But no. I will not do it. We know that that food is not good for us. I eat it, kya farak padta, it's only me. It's only me meaning you're not important for yourself. We always put ourselves at the bottom of the pile. Most important things come on the top, and then we go right at the bottom. Why? And then by the time we reach the bottom, we are too tired to serve ourselves. So everything goes. Health goes. Mental peace goes, sleep goes, as long as everybody else is taken care of. Who cares about me? At least I don't care enough about me. Passive aggressive behavior. This is another very classic symptom of anger and aggression that children report. Breath holding spasms. Very tiny babies, when they don't know how to show their aggression or anger, they hold their breath until they go blue. You also need to know where this child is getting this anxiety from, unless it's a neurological issue. That is something that a neurologist needs to check. If it is a neurological issue, it's going to be combined with very high fever, frequent vomiting. But otherwise, just holding your breath to teach your parent a lesson is also anger and aggression. And children are capable of it. Separation anxiety. Have you heard or do you know that birth is a very rude shock for the baby? The baby is so comfortable in the mother's stomach for 9 months. Very safely cocoon, beautiful temperature, beautiful water, nothing to worry, no light, no heat, no traffic. Kuch bhi nahi.
When the baby is in the womb.
When the baby is in the womb. When the baby is removed out, the baby is not comfortable. It's a very, very rude shock. They don't take it very well. That's why they come out and they cry. And they are uncomfortable. And after that they sleep, because their journey of coming from the womb to the outside world is a difficult one. So they are exhausted. Okay? That is the first time the child learns separation anxiety. Because till then the child didn't know that he and the mother were separate. The child always thought, we are one unit. We are one. So if she eats, I eat. If she drinks, I drink. She's not separate from me. When you separate the child and the child has to breathe on his own for the first time, drink on his own, suck on his own for the first time, it's too much responsibility. Like, who just took away my resources? Right? Separation anxiety starts then and continues until unless it is addressed. A lot of times parents also complain that my child is now 1.5 year old, my maternity leave is over, I have to go back to work. Or pata nahi how my child comes to know, when my child is sleeping, I wake up in the morning, I don't switch on any lights, I don't make any noise, I walk on tiptoes from my bed to the bathroom and back, I keep my clothes ready, I don't open my cupboard, there's no noise. But still, when I am getting ready, this child will wake up and cry. We don't know how he knows. Because the child doesn't wait to hear. The child smells the soap and the powder and the perfume. And when they smell those things, they realize every day when this smell comes after 5 minutes, this woman is gone. She's not there. So that means again this smell has come, again she's going to run away. Okay, smell is coming, let's start crying and throw a tantrum. When I throw a tantrum, she will sit there for half an hour. And this is the way separation anxiety develops, because the mother doesn't know, poor thing, what to do. Mother has to go to work. So every day she leaves the child crying, 5 minutes she'll sit, but she has a train to catch, she has a bus to catch. And then the child constantly starts feeling like, she just leaves me and goes, maybe I'm a bad child. So complexes can develop from separation anxiety. A good advice that we give to the mothers when the child is suffering from separation anxiety is that change your time, change your routine. When you wake up in the morning and when the child cries, spend time with the child. And only after the child has become busy in a lot of other things, when he is not missing you, then you can leave.
To spend some time with the child.
To spend some time with the child after you wake up.
In this. Children, they go to the school, at that time there is a separate anxiety, you know?
Yes, because they don't want to leave the mother, especially the play groups and the toddler houses and all of that. Till they are junior, senior, they have this separation anxiety. By the time they are 6 years old, they come into the first standard, they are very comfortable.
So solution, they should spend some time.
Spend time after you wake up.
Give a hug and then...
Hugs, so all mothers give. But children are greedy, they want more. Ek se mera kya hoga? So they want 1 hour, 2 hours, which sometimes gets a little impractical. So for that 1 year, we ask the parents to adjust their timings accordingly. And if your child is still not ready, better to take 1 year off and start working when your child is ready. Because that 2 years of monetary loss is not going to be as big as compared to the lifetime anxiety created in your child. Because then this baby grows up thinking, I'm not good enough, my mother doesn't love me, she always left me and went, I don't have anybody. This is how belief systems develop in our space. We always feel like, I never got enough. when the second child was born, she got a lot of attention because by that time the mother didn't have the energy to cope up with two children and go to work, she left work. So that a child can't think logically. He or she will think, when the second one was born, no, at that time she was there full time. For me, she was not there. So we end up creating more and more complexes for our children. Okay, so just be a little more aware of what the child is going through. Anxiety can also cause asthma. If you have a child in a case where there is constant asthma, we need to check whether the child is very anxious or there is a lot of overfeeding of information or the parents are all the time on the child's head. Because there are core psychological reasons for asthma. Then there is also stuttering. When they stutter while they speak, that is stuttering can also be part of anxiety and obsessive compulsive disorders. You know the children and the people, if you've heard 20 times in a day they have to go and wash their hands. Even if they hold the handle of a door, they have to sanitize their hands. They just can't eat without checking. Bahar ka khana nahi khayenge. Their plate has to be cleaned 10 times. Obsessive compulsive disorders about neatness, about washing, about cleanliness, about a lot of things. Constant worry again caused by anxiety. Okay? TV and electronic addiction is one of the main and major reasons why we are losing a lot of the mental health of our children today. As parents, we think that our love is in giving them the best there is to offer. So even a parent of a middle class home who possibly can't afford a very expensive phone for himself will still save up and give the child an iPad. Because obviously all the children have iPads. And if my child doesn't have one, I feel like I'm not being a good parent. So I give them an iPad. And then the child doesn't leave that iPad. Then I get angry. Then I complain. Work with that iPad the whole time. But isn't this something that we see in all the houses? If it's not the iPad, it's the phone. If it's not the phone, it's a video game. Electronic addiction is humongous. And trust me, it is as bad as alcoholic addiction, cigarette smoking addiction, pornographic addiction. Would you give your child a glass of whiskey to drink? No, right? In the same way, what's happening in the brain is almost the same reaction that is caused by electronics also. So this is our brain. When we are waking up in the morning and when we are asleep in the night, the brain works on a very, very soothing wave. This is soothing. Then when we get busy, this is how the brain starts working. Have you heard of alpha, beta, theta, gamma?
Yeah.
Right? These are the alpha, beta, theta, gamma waves. Then when we are in sleep or when we are meditating, this is what happens to our brain wave. Attention is there, attention is not there. Attention is there, it's not there. I'm present, I'm absent. Again, I'm present, again, I'm absent. It keeps going on. For studying, these two waves are the best. And this happens early morning when we are waking up, when the day hasn't started full-fledged. When we watch TV constantly, addicted to TV, so 1 hour of TV, 2 hours of TV, 3 hours of TV, 4 hours of TV a day, if not TV, iPad. There are so many scenes that are going on, every second a scene is changing, so many colors going on, so much sound going on. Zara sa bhi slow ho gaya. Immediately I change the channel. So many channels available. So there is so much of information that my brain has to process. Light, color, sound, dialogues, action, everything, emotions. Okay? If I have to process so much, my brain has to work at a much higher speed. It can't process at this speed. So this is what happens to the brain. This is the kind of brain wave that is generated. Now this brain wave is addictive. This kind of brain wave is capable of destroying this, this, and this. And we definitely can't do slow focus areas in this way. We can't study. A classic practice in all homes. Okay, now you watch TV, switch off the TV, now sit with your books. After that, watch TV, my brain wave is here. For my brain wave to go from this to come back to this or this,
This transition takes 45 minutes. So if I switch off the TV and if I say, okay, I'm going to study for 45 minutes, nothing is going in my head. So again and again, you're just shouting at the child, saying, focus! So much TV you watched, enough now! But it can't penetrate. Jai nahi sakta. You can't run a Concorde plane on a Rajdhani platform, right? You can't run it on that track. These are different tracks altogether. That's why we say, spend some time in the morning after the child wakes up, because it's on the best wave to study. Or in the night before the child is going to sleep. Right?
But even when there are educational games available on these devices, then too you have...
Still it is electronic, no? What happens is that once we get addicted, we are addicted. Then we can't leave it. Try snatching an iPad from your child and see what happens. The same thing when you don't give cocaine or heroin to a drug addict. They will throw a fit, they will loll on the floor, they have no shame. They will embarrass you in the restaurant. They will go on the floor and they will cry on the floor and the other parents will think, Bapre kya rakshas na bapre.
Right.
And what is your choice? Okay, take it. For that moment, the child got what he wanted. Because the brain is not going to be able to do without it. Whether he's playing educational games or anything else, today it's education. What do you know after that what it is? How many times have you read your comics, Archie's under a history book? Did your parents know? No, their children are much better and much smarter than that. Right, so today it is this, tomorrow it will be something else. Slowly, slowly the human contact keeps getting reduced. And the iPad contact and the internet contact keeps getting higher and higher. What are the problems that we have with electronic addiction? The child doesn't know how to socialize. They have 2,000 friends on Facebook, but they don't have two friends in real. Because one, who will go down and play if I can play on the TV? Why put that physical effort? So they don't want to go down. Secondly, you are not speaking to human beings anymore, so you don't know how to converse, you don't know how to talk. Thirdly, you lose patience. So all of this is taking you away from reality. They don't know the kind of games we played at all. Now it feels like a 3-generation gap. If you try to tell your son we played Bagori or we played this Pakrapakri, they'll be like, you're mad. Okay, let's play Temple Run on the iPad instead. That's also like Pakrapakri. But they don't want to go down. It's more effort.
But what is the correct age one would like, you know, maybe...
Give a gadget. Give a gadget by all means, once a week. Twice a week. Or under your supervision. You want to play with this, you're going to play with this every day, 15 minutes, with no problem, when I'm around. Not more than 15 to 20 minutes. Because when you're not there, children are now the way we used to take newspapers to the bathrooms, children take iPads to the bathrooms. It just doesn't stop. It just keeps going on and on. Risks are too many. And not being able to study is one of them. Not being able to sleep is another. They just can't sleep because the brain is so active. Active brains don't like sleep. They don't even want to eat because they're in such a hurry that my show is going to be missed. They'd rather drink rather than eat. Or if they eat, they're putting on more and more weight because the cereal is going on for 2 hours, so my food is going on for 2 hours. Grandmothers think ki TV dekhte dekhte do roti aur kha raha hai na, let him watch. But then they're not aware of how much and what they're eating. Weight is another issue. It just escalates from one to the other. Sudden changes in behavior could also be addictions. When you feel like this child was not like this before, now there are a lot of changes. Excessive sleeping, excessive eating, excessive need for money, the need to be outside the house or the need to be in the bathroom all the time. Check for other addictions. Check if he is being exposed to drugs, depending on what school he is in. There are drug addiction cases which are coming to us right now from the 6th standard onwards. So from the time the child would be 12 to 13 years old. And the kind of drugs that they do, sniffing turpentine, putting iodex on a slice of bread and eating it, Fericol, all of these are drugs which are leaving children high. So they don't have to go out and buy that cocaine or buy anything else that is available there. There is a lot of stuff that they can use even from the normal stores that they get.
So again, if there's a lot of change in behavior, always keep your eyes aware, keep your mind aware for what is the change and what is this child doing differently. TV addictions can also cause a lot of speech delays, because I'm only hearing the whole time and I'm mentally talking to that chota bhim, or I'm mentally talking to the Doraemon. If I'm mentally talking, there's a lot of talking going on in my head but not in my throat. I don't learn to speak only. I speak much later in my life. By that time the parents are already panicked. Then we check for auditory levels. Sun to raha hai, is he able to listen? Right, all these issues again come up from TV and
so what is the age one starts speaking as such? Usually depends on kid to kid.
Depends, the girls start speaking faster than the boys. By one and a half, they are blabbering a lot of mama, papa, out, in, everything. They are saying all of that stuff. By 3, the child is proficient. By 4, the child should pick up the secondary language also. So if the primary language is Gujarati or the primary language is Hindi, and by 4, the child is exposed to the secondary language, they should be able to pick up the secondary language. Yeah? Then there are some kind of learning disabilities that the child goes through, and these are again very common, which normal people are not really exposed to. They think there is something wrong with my child, that my child is not able to study well. What are learning disabilities? Learning disabilities are when you have normal intelligence but there is a problem in one or more areas of your learning. So either I can't read properly, or I can't write properly, or I can't do numbers. When I can't read properly, this is something that we call dyslexic. You remember the movie Taare Zameen Par? When the boy had issues with reading and writing and all his words used to float in front of his eyes and he just couldn't get his spellings correct. Every page had 10 circles over it. Wrong. But very intelligent child. You give the child a 1,000-piece puzzle and they'll put it together like this. They'll play games like this. They'll do computers like this. But problems with reading, language, become something which we call dyslexia. When I cannot write properly, maybe I can read but I can't write, it becomes dysgraphia. When I can't do numbers, I can't follow sequence. Agar you have given me an instruction that first you have to do this, then this, then this, then this, then this, and I get mixed up in the sequence, like what did he say? What was I supposed to do first? I did the fourth thing first and the third thing second. When I get mixed up with sequences, it's something we call dyscalculia. Problem with directions, right, left, straight, uske baad aisa, uske baad aisa, can't remember directions, again check for dyscalculia. A lot of children are passed off thinking that they are just not good at maths or they don't like maths. But a lot of these kids have a solid fear of maths. And that fear of maths needs to be checked for a dyscalculia problem, because they genuinely may not be able to function with numbers. And there is a lot of push because we are a left brain country. So the education is more based on English, math, science, how are you on all of those. People don't care how good you are at dancing or how good you are at painting or photography. They really think it's a waste of time. Focus on your math, focus on your science, focus on your English. And here is where the learning disabilities come up the most. It means that the child is intelligent but needs a different way of learning, or needs a special teacher who can be a remedial teacher, who can teach them separately. Okay? Language, reading, writing, reasoning, maths, social behavior, organizing your time, etc. If you're having problems in all these areas, check for the learning disability. It could happen because of factors like low birth weight, prematurity, poor nutrition, heredity, diabetes, asthma, head injuries, all of these could be reasons for learning disabilities. All behavior problems can come from learning disabilities if your child has a learning disability. Because the child knows that I'm not good at this, I can't do this, and they are frustrated themselves. When they are frustrated, there's going to be aggression or there's going to be suppression. One of these two, aggression hai toh, he'll go and hit 2-3 other people, he'll go and destroy the school boxes, then he'll go and tear the books of other children also under anger and aggression. Or the child will completely succumb to suppression. Again, behavior issue, behavior change. I don't like people, I don't want to talk to anybody, I don't want to go to school. Check for an LP.
Okay.
The third one is, this happened in the mother's womb. It could happen because of...
It could happen because of factors like
the
birth weight.
Baby's mother.
Yes. A lot of times, especially in countries like America, where mothers are very prone to smoking and drugs and drinking, children do suffer from a lot of prematurity, a lot of damage in the brain before even the child is born. And yes, that does give rise to learning disabilities too. Which LDs are common? Dyslexia, dysgraphia, dyscalculia, ADD, attention deficit disorder. Like how I told you that there are these 4-5 waves to the brain. What happens in ADD is that my attention is there, my attention is lost. Attention comes again, attention is lost again. Comes again, it's lost again. So this is a child who the teachers will classically say is a daydreamer. Half the time he's not paying attention. Half the answer is written, the other two answers are not written. He forgot his compass box. He always forgets his books in school. If you ask him what happened in school, he says, I don't remember. When they have problems with remembering or retaining or focusing, you need to focus on whether it's an ADD. These children are very sensitive. The upside of ADD is they can be very creative, but they are very soft-hearted kids. To bring them back to attention, all you have to do is just snap and say, are you back with me? Don't hit these children. Be very aware of your actions on them because they can get into a depression very quickly. Because they know that they are weak somewhere. And then there is ADHD. ADHD is this wave, which is hyperactive. It's the opposite of ADD. Where I'm always hyper. If you see some kids, they just can't stand in one place. They have to open this door and they have to check this wire where it's going and they have to go behind that camera and see who's there and they have to open the laptop and see what programs are playing. Or if they're just standing, they'll be tapping their feet or they're constantly on the mobile or they talk very fast. High energy, you can't control, their mother is tired, like, boss, do something about this child. Or ADHD. Attention deficit, hyperactivity disorder. They can't calm down. They can't relax. To get them to relax, you have to give them medication. Or they need therapy. Very, very hyper. Then there is oppositional defiance disorder, ODD. Rare cases again, but again they could also be coming from ADHD. That means you tell this child to do something and they will do just the opposite. They get a kick out of defying you. They get a kick out of breaking rules. They are the ones who get into a lot of trouble with authorities. Constantly in trouble with teachers, with principals, later with police. They are the ones who become these juvenile criminals. ODD, oppositional defiance disorder. And then there is anxiety, depression and OCD, obsessive compulsive disorder. Like I said, 20 times washing, very very particular, ek baal bhi nikal gaya, I'm losing my hair. They'll go and open up 10 books and check for hair loss. They can't relax about small changes. Changes are very discomforting for them. Yeah? Okay, very quickly, what is ADD? Forgetfulness, lack of concentration, daydreaming, easily bored, indulging in risky behavior, careless mistakes. The child has a hard time following oral or written instructions and makes frequent mistakes. The positive side of ADD, very imaginative, very creative. These children can be child wonders in creativity. In dance, in singing, in music, in painting. In performing arts, they can be wonderful. Then there's ADHD, cannot concentrate, speaks too fast, resists sleep, defiant behavior, no patience for eating, very adventurous, taking risks all the time, cannot control their behavior. Anxiety parents lead to hyperactive children. If the parent is very anxious, it will lead to a hyperactive child. The positive side of these children is spontaneity. Kabhi bhi kuch bhi karenge. Right now, they will come up with something new. They can have very creative ideas, very spontaneous. ADHD cases, if confronted too often, if you constantly tell a child, you know, you're not good enough, you should be doing this, you should be sitting down, you should be relaxing. Then they lose it and then they become oppositional defiance disorder cases. Like now, go to hell. I've had enough of you, now I'll show you what I can do. That is the birthplace of OPD. A hyperactive wave is the birthplace of learning disabilities. And this comes from where?
electronic addiction also, majorly, as of now. What do the parents need to be careful of? If the parents really can do something to manage all this mental health and all this behavior and all these risks, reward good behavior. Pay attention to all the things that they're doing right and appreciate them for that. That I really appreciated, you know, when you were sitting nicely at a party and talking to everybody and you finished all your food on your plate, I feel very happy. You look like a really well brought up child. It makes me so proud. Even small things, if they picked up their plate, they put it in the sink, good job. Please do it every day. I really like it when you can do this. The more attention and affection and appreciation that you give for the things that they are doing right, they will reduce doing the things that they are not doing right. Second, punish bad behavior. It is not to be tolerated. Punishing does not mean hitting or screaming. Punishing means sitting them down, taking away a certain privilege and saying, if you continue to do this, this privilege will be taken away from you every day. Cutting out the TV, cutting out the iPad time, cutting out pocket money. All of these things can be punishing bad behavior. And very clearly tell them, we are not okay with this.
But this can be even rebellious, right? I mean,
not necessary. Children get rebellious when you force on something. But what you also need to know as parents is consistency is the key word. Today you gave punishment. Tomorrow you let it go. So one parent punished. Mother said, sit down here, you're not going to move for half an hour. No harsh punishment. Mara nahi hai. Not hit, not scream, not shout it. But time out. Sit down here. You're not getting up from here. Father comes, are why are you sitting here? And the child is like, mama punished. Aye, mama doesn't know anything. Come, get up, come. We'll go watch TV. Finished. What does the child learn? More politics. Now every time I can throw a tantrum exactly at 9:30, because papa comes at 9:45. So whatever I want to at 9:30, I'll throw a tantrum at that time, mama will punish me, I'll sit down, your papa will give me double. So that becomes a daily habit, a daily routine. And that's when the fights between the parents starts. Like one is trying to discipline, the other is trying to be the hero. Playing one parent against the other. Be consistent even with your punishments, and the child has to know that my parents together are not going to be okay with this. And trust me, children appreciate boundaries. They need to know what they can do, what they can't do. Because again, they don't know. They're born in a free world. They don't know that it's dangerous to touch fire. They know because you tell them that. Right? In the same way, you have to tell them that you have to be home at 8 o'clock no matter where you've gone. You have to call me at 6 o'clock and tell me when you're coming back. These are certain rules and they are for your safety and they are for your security. If the child is going to ask you, but why should I follow a rule like that? And the mother says, because I said so. Finish. Then the child is learning rebelliousness. Give the child a logical reasoning. That look, beta, it's for your safety. This is why you need to do this so that we know that you are safe. Nothing else. We don't care to control you. But until unless you learn to be responsible, we are responsible for you. Okay? Boundaries, like I said, they need to know clearly, consistency and modeling. 65% body language, children are learning as they are seeing. If you are a good model to your child will be a good model back for you and the society. But if you are in Santa Cruz and you are speaking to your husband and you say, yeah, I've crossed Bandra, I'm coming. And the child is like, chul bola. It's okay. Main bol sakta hu. It's okay to lie. And then when the child lies, then you give one fat. And then the child will start rebelling. What is this? You lie, it's okay. I lie, it's not okay. Mixed messages. The child is not learning the right discipline. Be very careful. If you don't want your child to shout, don't shout. If you want your child to be peaceful, demonstrate peace. If you want your child to be happy, demonstrate happiness. If you want your child to give attention, don't talk to your child while doing WhatsApp. Because your child is going to do that as soon as he gets a phone. And then you can forget all about the eye contact. And then we'll complain that, look,
He doesn't care, he has no respect. How much we respected our elders. Yeah, we did have WhatsApp at that time, no, that's why. WhatsApp is taking away a lot of personal contact. When you want something, you have to give it unadulterated. Then in a battle between a relationship and discipline, if you have come to the last straw of the relationship where your relationship is getting spoiled for your child, if it is so bad that either you can have a good relationship or you can have the discipline from the child, choose a relationship. If not you, employ somebody else to teach the child discipline. You can employ a counselor. You can employ another mentor. Somebody else will teach your child discipline at the right time, or your child will learn on its own. But once you've lost the relationship, there's no chance your child is learning from you in any case. Right? Save your relationship, the discipline will keep coming. Pay more close attention to the mental health of your children, and I'm sure that they will grow wonderfully, so will you. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you, everyone.